And welcome to the 4th annual birthday broadcast, brought to you by Silver Dome Radio and a division of Silver Dome Productions. I'm your host, Thurgood Van Ivers. Today we have an adventure of excitement, world travel, intrigue, romance, competition, and let's not forget, danger. Joining us today in the cast, we have Anne Goodling.
Hello.
Alex Goodling.
Hey there.
Sam Branshaw.
What's up?
Tajson.
Hello.
Casey Somerville.
Hi.
David Somerville.
Hello.
And our very own, much esteemed, much beloved, nigh upon revered, Jason James Wilberforce Hearthwist Cunningham the Fifth.
I think he canceled. He's gonna have to come back later.
And now, join us as we plunge into the adventure of Par Avant. In the heart of Iowa, there is a small town called Waterford. It's a place that time has left largely unchanged. And in the heart of Waterford is the small one-room schoolhouse. Its red roof glints in the sun, and little birds like to come and nestle under the eaves. And down below, skip and play the small children who go to the school. As they run in and out of the building, their joyous little voices fill the door and the hallways.
Good morning, Miss Everby. I love you.
Good morning, Johnny.
Good morning, Miss Everby. I'm a bit of a voice.
And in the heart of that one-room schoolhouse was Miss Annie M. Appleby.
Now let's settle down and begin our lessons for today, everyone.
Oh, Miss Appleby, Miss Appleby.
What is it, Johnny?
I've lost my chalk.
Again?
It's the fourth piece, I'm sorry.
Well, I'll give you another piece as long as you don't eat it this time, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Miss Appleby was a kindly and noble soul. She was from a wealthy family and had spent much of her early life traveling the world, but had now decided that it was time to settle down and to do some good. And she loved teaching the little children, and they loved her as well. At the end of every day, Miss Appleby would give them all pats on their heads and send them home to their mother's house for apple pie and for milk. And each one of them tended to leave a shiny red apple on her desk in thanks of her noble efforts for them. One day, as she was packing up her things to go home, Annie M. Appleby heard a knock at the door.
Hey, Annie.
Oh, hello, Godfrey. How are you today?
Well, I'm doing pretty well. I was just wondering, since it's almost, you know, the close of the school, if I could walk you home.
Yes, thank you. That would be wonderful.
Well, you never know, with the fences being kind of rusty around here and the cows being out, you might get trampled, and I wouldn't want that to happen. If it's for the children, of course.
Oh, how thoughtful of you, Godfrey. I would love to walk home with you.
Oh, wonderful. Can I carry your books for you?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, do you They're always carry heavy. The Encyclopedia Britannica?
Godfrey was a strong young Iowa farm boy who had grown up in the small town of Waterford. And he had never known anyone quite like Annie Appleby.
I've never told anyone this before, but I stole a peanut from Mr. McGovern's store, and I swept it out his entire store to pay for it. I felt so bad.
And Annie had never known anyone quite like Godfrey Goodhart.
Yes, I think I've been to that store myself. You know, they have apples there. I think my children buy them for me every day.
Why don't we go to Mr. McGovern's for some sodas?
Oh, well, I have some things to do, but I think I have a little time, maybe.
Godfrey always seemed to know the right thing to say, the right thing to do. It's just full of a warm heart and a good outlook on life and...
Hey,
And as they walked along the road, a motor car pulled up.
Oh, Lawrence, is that you?
Hello, Annie.
Oh, hi, Lawrence. How are you doing?
Hello, Godfrey.
How's life in the city?
It's fine. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing very well.
It's nice to see you, Annie.
Thank you, Lawrence. That's a lovely car.
You look lovely today.
Thank you.
What are you doing later?
Nothing really, I don't think.
Well, Annie and I were just
Why don't you let me take you out for some refinement?
Well, we were just about to go, to the ice cream parlor McGovern's and...
I'd love to go out with you, Lawrence.
Well, you enjoy Godfrey, then you call me later, okay?
Okay.
Nice to see you again, Annie.
Lawrence had gone to school at an Ivy League institution and had recently returned with his diploma. He was all the talk of the town. Everyone was saying, "Oh, Lawrence, Lawrence!" Everyone wanted to know where he'd been, what he'd seen.
"Oh, Lawrence, tell me about your time in the big city."
"Oh, you've such a grown-up so much. That's quite a mustache you have, young man."
"Yes, I certainly have grown up. Very true. But it's nice to be back."
Does the town seem smaller, or does the world just seem very large?"
"The world is quite large, but I do enjoy coming back to the small town.
Oh, Alfred, you
Especially
know.
You get to see Annie. Dear, dear Annie.
Oh, I should
I just adore her.
I should tell
Let
you.
Let me talk some more.
I should tell you, Lawrence, that I'm afraid her heart might be engaged."
"Oh, Alfred, you know you can't keep a city boy in a small town like this. They just go skippering off as soon as they get back again."
"That's a good point. You'll probably be gone then that Godfrey Goodheart fellow will marry Annie."
"Well, I never forgot where I came from, and I'm glad to be back to see Annie M. Appleby."
Godfrey took Annie to the local carnival.
"Oh, I thought you'd like the carousel."
"Popcorn, get your popcorn."
I would love to get into the carousel. You know, the lights here are so fabulous. They're so amazing, aren't they?"
"Oh, yeah. Look over there at the merry-go-round. Look at those children. That's some of your students over there."
"Oh, hello, buddy."
"Oh, look. You want to go bang the big, bell thing?"
I'm not sure I'd do so well at that game, but why don't you try?"
"Oh, all right. Give me a hammer. How much does it cost?"
Just a nickel."
Here you go. All right, are you ready? Annie, watch this."
"Okay."
"Oh, look at that.
That was a good one, thing, but take another try.
"Okay, I'll give it one more time. Oh, look at that. Well.
You are, good man. Now, you come on, try another game. Come on,
Annie, what do you want to do?
Let's go ride up on the carousel or something like that.
Oh, let's go ride the carousel.
Yeah. Step right up.
Oh. So, Annie, there's something I've been meaning to talk to you about for a long time.
Oh?
And I haven't really worked up the nerve.
Hey, you young man!
Oh yeah. Well, hi.
Man, would you like to play the milk bottle game?
What's the milk bottle game?
You take this little ball here and you knock it into those milk bottles. If you knock them all over, you get a stuffed animal for the young lady right there.
Annie, I'm going to win you a stuffed animal.
Oh, can you get me the pink one?
I'm going to get you the pink. Anything you want. Let me try it. Here's my nickel.
Here goes,
all right. All righty.
You can do it.
Come on, stuffed animal.
It was a good try, guys.
Sorry, son, you only got one now. You have one more ball, though.
Okay. Come on, stuffed animal.
Ow!
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I'm sorry, son. Don't get a stuffed animal. Sorry, miss.
It's all right.
Want to try again?
I don't know. I don't know.
Hello, Annie.
Just at that moment, Lawrence walked up.
Lawrence.
I thought you'd be here. Hello, Godfrey.
Hey, Lawrence, how you doing?
What have you been doing?
We were just playing the milk bottle game.
I'm talking to Annie, Godfrey.
Oh, we've just been walking around a bit and seeing all the pretty lights and riding the carousel.
Are you enjoying it? Is Godfrey taking care of you?
Oh, we've been having lots of fun, thank you.
Godfrey, please.
Oh. Well, yes, I suppose.
What?
So how about that refinement we talked about? Would you like to go out later?
Yes, I'd love to. Maybe.
Well, I was just failing at throwing the milk thing because it's just, I think it's impossible to do. Isn't that right, Annie?
Amanda, would you like to try? Would you like to try and win?
I'd love to.
Wonderful stuffed animal for this young lady.
Let's give it a try.
Here you go.
I'm telling you, it's impossible. No man can do that.
Got it.
Wow, first try. This is great.
Well, there you go.
That's amazing.
Man.
What do I get?
Which stuffed animal would you like for the young lady?
I'll take the big bear.
Ooh. Here you go. You got nice taste.
Here you go, Annie.
Thank you, Lawrence.
Well, I'm glad you
did your best, Godfrey.
As long as Annie's happy, that's what counts.
Maybe you can go back to being a farmhand.
Well, I am a farmhand. Okay, well. Okay.
Say, Annie, what do you think we get out of here?
I'd love to.
Let's go.
All right.
Godfrey, we'll see you soon. Right?
Goodbye, okay, Godfrey. I'll see you tomorrow.
I got a parking validation.
As time passed on and continued, Annie found herself more and more conflicted within her heart as to which of the young men really her affections lay with. Little was this on Godfrey's mind, however, as he walked up to Annie's front porch one bright morning.
Oh, Annie, will you marry me? Oh, no. Annie, will you marry me?
Clutching some yellow daisies he had plucked from a nearby field,
marry me?
Godfrey braced himself.
Well, Manny, Harry, Mary?
Godfrey was a simple country boy, but
Mary?
Annie had stolen
Annie,
his heart.
Annie, will you
All he
marry
knew was
me?
That he loved her and he wanted to be with her for the rest of
Please
his days.
Please marry me, Annie.
Little did he expect a tap on the shoulder from the person
he least
wanted to see.
Marry me! Oh!
Godfrey, what are you doing here?
Lawrence, what are
I
you doing here?
I thought you were
here?
Away for the weekend.
I came back.
Your mother said you went west.
I was going out to the pond to think things over for a little bit, and I'm done thinking.
What were you thinking about?
Oh, nothing important.
What's on your mind, Godfrey?
I was just, these flowers needed...
Godfrey, I want to marry Annie. That's why I'm here to ask.
Oh, huh. Well, isn't that ironic? Annie...
You can't have her, Godfrey. She's mine.
No. All right.
They bumped into the doorbell. And the door creaked open.
She's mine, Godfrey. She's mine.
Hello?
Mrs. Appleby?
Yes?
You look lovely today, Mrs. Appleby.
Thank you.
Don't mind him. Is Annie in?
Yes. Why?
Is there something new with your hair today, Mrs. Appleby?
Yeah, your hair looks great, Mrs. Appleby. Could I see Annie? Here, why don't you two talk, and I'll just go talk to Annie.
Absolutely not.
Where is
come
Annie?
In. Hush. Both of you, come in and sit on the sofa.
That sounds lovely. Oh,
okay.
I will go up and get my daughter.
Going down, Lawrence. Annie's a good girl, so I'll never go for a guy like
you. You're nothing but a farm boy, Godfrey.
She knows you're a
farm boy. I'm above you, and you know it.
Oh, you don't. You want
to Is something wrong? Annie!
Yes?
There are some very nice boys here to see you.
Oh? Who?
I didn't ask their names. God, somebody, and the law, I think.
The Lord is here?
I'm gonna get you, Lauren. She'll never go for a guy like you.
I'll go down and talk to them, I guess.
Good.
I'm very persuasive, Godfrey.
No, you're not!
Godfrey, Lawrence!
Hello, Annie. It's nice to see you again.
I got you flowers. They're your favorite color.
Oh, they are. Yellow is my favorite. Thank
I brought you,
you
roses,
Godfrey.
Annie, from Sicily. They're very rare and pretentious, just like I like them.
I love roses. They're my favorite flower,
Lawrence.
Don't grip
those too tightly. They'll rip your hands apart with the thorns.
No, they're thornless. That's why they're so rare.
Oh.
How Annie, thoughtful.
Can I speak to you?
Yes, Godfrey. What is it?
In private? Without Lawrence?
Yes, of course. Well, Yes, I suppose there's a room right across the hall here.
Oh,
I'll
thank you.
I'll just be here, Annie, okay?
Oh. Okay, Lawrence.
Come back soon.
What is it, Godfrey?
Oh, well, here's when I was, you know, for some time I've been thinking about, you know, you and me and us and you and me and the two of us together.
Annie, I can't wait anymore. I have to talk to you.
Well, just a minute, Lawrence.
Annie, I have to talk to you
Annie,
now.
He burst through the door.
Oh,
Annie, please.
Oh, Lawrence,
is the
get
door
out.
Unhurt?
Annie, it's very important.
No, it's not as important as what I have to say.
What is...
Oh,
and suddenly the crowded room was full.
Annie, what are you doing?
Oh,
Miss
Mallaby, Lawrence is
But
like,
then Godfrey took control.
Okay, stop, everyone. That's true, remain calm.
And told Annie what was on his mind.
Annie, I love you, and I want you to marry me.
But Lawrence jumped in.
Annie, it is I, who love you. Annie, will you marry me?
Be quiet, Lawrence, that's not true. Don't make up things.
Godfrey,
don't lie to the
Godfrey, girl. Who are you? Step aside, Godfrey.
Both
Annie.
Marry me.
Both of
Annie.
You want to marry me?
I've known you for years. You
know
who I am.
Too.
Godfrey, stop.
I've known you.
Wait a minute!
Mother!
What is going on?
I'd like to marry your daughter.
Mrs. Appleby, I love your daughter, and I want to marry her.
And so, it was all up to Annie. The decision, the happiness of two men and herself rested on what she'd say right now. She took a deep, cleansing breath and said,
I choose.
We'll return after this brief commercial break.
Nurse, this is the first attempted stomach transplant in history.
Sir?
We had better not screw this up.
Okay.
Scalpel.
Forceps.
Dr. Small's denture adhesive for the important times.
Not guaranteed to work in all situations. Please consult a medical professional before using it.
We now return to the fourth annual birthday broadcast, Par Avion.
I choose...
Wait!
Mother?
Don't you remember that promise I had you make me 4 or 5 years ago?
But... No? What promise was that?
The promise that the man you would marry... would be the most traveled man in the entire world.
But neither of them have been out of the States. How does that apply?
A promise is a promise is a promise.
Oh, well, I once went to the state fair next state over, Kansas.
I traveled extensively while at Yale.
But
I've seen much of Europe, Annie. I know what's out there.
But I know
I could take you anywhere.
Well, it must be a duel of wits.
What? But I know who I want.
Just then, there was a knock at the door.
Oh.
Mr. Lawrence? Mr. Lawrence? Oh.
How did you find me here? This is not my residence.
Who are you?
I heard your voice. I was just sitting here delivering the mail for the Applebee's, and... Oh, I have a letter for you. Here.
Do you have a letter opener on you?
Oh, just open the letter already.
Let's take a look.
What is it? I was asking that, Mother. What does it say, Lawrence?
Yeah, what does it say?
What does it say?
It says I have to go to war.
War!
Had been drafted. The yellow letter shook in his hands as he realized he would have to go to war.
Annie!
He left the next day on the express train to Des Moines.
Bye, Annie. I'll see you again soon.
Godfrey's hopes soared until...
I'll take care of her for you, Lauren!
Until Annie reminded him of her promise.
You know, Godfrey, I did make that promise to my mother. And, well, if Lawrence is going out of the States and you aren't, he wins.
Well, then I'll enlist. That's what I'll do. I'll enlist.
No.
In the Navy. Annie, goodbye. I'll be back shortly. Don't worry. I'll write you every day, every week, every moment. I'll be thinking of you.
But you could die.
Good. Don't worry about that. You're worth it. You're worth the risk.
No, I'm not.
Goodbye, Annie.
And so he ran off. He ran to the enlistment office. He didn't even stop by his house. He just got on the next train. As the countryside rolled past, he knew what he had to do. He had no choice. He had to outrace Lawrence and see more of the world than he did if he was ever going to win the heart of Annie M. Appleby. Two days later, Godfrey stepped off the train and into the bustling military camp of Des Moines, Iowa.
Oh, goodness, look at all this.
Soldier, ball right there.
Oh, hut two. Oh, my goodness.
Come on.
Well, first step in seeing the world. Better write a postcard about this one. Tell Annie.
And just as he was writing his postcard, the most unwelcome person walked up.
Say, is that you, Godfrey?
Lawrence, what are you doing here?
Fancy meeting you here.
Oh, what do you know?
What do you think you're doing here?
Oh, I'm joining the Navy.
Oh, like hell you are.
Yeah, that's my ship over there.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Where are you headed?
I think we're heading to the South Pacific.
Lovely.
Oh, listen, the whistle's blowing, but I have an idea. The only way to measure who's seen more of the world, if you agree, is to send postcards back to Annie so she knows where we've been.
I agree. Well, clearly, because I'm going all over the world.
Mm-hmm. But in the Navy, everyone knows you see the world. Join the Navy, you see the world.
Army strong.
Ha! That's right. Well, you'll need every ounce of that strength. Well, may the best man win.
Best of luck, Godfrey.
Better luck next time.
And so, with those parting words, the race was on.
Take it to sea! Ha-ha!
They traveled the world, the two of them.
Take that, Lawrence. We're off to see the Sphinx.
Don't fall over, Godfrey.
Ha!
And so they raced around the world.
Dearest.
Godfrey was in his gunboat, and as he labored hard, his courage earned him swift promotions as he saw more and more of this wide world.
Godfrey, we're making you commander of your own gunboat.
Meanwhile, Lawrence was rising through the ranks in his own way, with his smooth talk and way with people. He had joined the intelligence corps and was quickly becoming a more and more important officer.
Brilliant, son, brilliant. Another promotion for you.
Thanks, sir. I enjoy my job greatly.
But neither of these mattered as much as seeing the next place, being on the move. Godfrey wrote to Annie.
Dearest Annie, today I saw the Sphinx and the pyramids. What majestic creations of man they are.
What are you doing? Get down
from
here! Get off that nose!
Dearest Annie, today I thought about you as I strolled through the busy city streets of, Middle Europe, and... Annie, I find it hard to live without you. I hope you think of me as I think of you now. I hope to be home soon.
Dearest Annie, today we reached Istanbul, formerly known as Constantinople, the great donate location for some of history's greatest events. I think of you often, and when I think of the great history this world has enjoyed, I think of all that which your kids are learning from you.
Dearest Annie, today I was in the south of Italy, and I cannot help but think of you as I scoured the landscape and thought of us coming here to retire and sit back and enjoy life and love it and live it.
Hey, you want another pizza?
Dearest Annie, today we reached the coast of the Ivory Coast of Africa. And I saw some of the most magnificant natives ever. I have a strange suspicion they think I'm a god. But all this god can think of is his goddess, you.
Dearest Annie, today I am in the heart of China, scaling the wall and walking it. I would walk miles to get to you, Annie, thousands of miles. As I peer out to the vast Chinese landscape, I think of you, and all I want is you, Annie.
And so, postcard after postcard flew through the air.
Dearest Annie,
and there they went, over the Atlantic, cresting over the sea, in boats by air, and making their way by train, to the heart of Iowa, to a tiny town known as Waterford, and to the tiny one-room schoolhouse where Annie read and counted the letters.
Miss Appleby!
Oh, yes, Johnny.
I have another postcard.
Oh, who is it from this time?
I think it's from Godfrey.
Oh, how sweet of him. He visited the Sphinx. It looks like he broke it. Oh, dear, but that's so like him.
What's the Sphinx?
Oh, well, children, in the pyramids of Egypt, there's a...
Annie was sorting out the postcards, and so far they were even. There were 58 from each of the men, and they had seen 58 new and exciting places. The strange thing about Lawrence's postcards was his handwriting varied so much from postcard to postcard, and he seemed to travel very, very quickly from place to place, almost impossibly so. Annie just assumed that it was a part of the war that all that happened, but the truth was much more sinister. And the truth was why Lawrence Wright was sneaking across the no man's land into the German compound at the dead of midnight.
Halt! Who goes there? What is the password?
Red flag.
Right this way. My general.
Yes.
Lawrence is here. Trust you.
Excellent. Send him in.
Hello, Gregor.
Hello.
Good to see you again.
Yes, as always.
I brought you some information. Do you have what I need?
yes. We've been sending your postcards, but we've come up against some difficulties.
What is the problem?
Well, it appears that this man, Godfrey, we cannot send as many as he is from so many places.
You see, our men are having trouble getting to the same places that Godfrey got to on his boat.
You need to figure something out. I need this done. We spoke about this. What is the problem?
Why is this so
important? What is the problem? Figure it out.
Why is this so important to you?
It's important to me because I have a lot of debt from my years at Yale. I do not love her. Their family is very wealthy.
You see, the problem is that Deutschland cannot afford to keep paying you tons and tons of money. And Mother Russia, she cannot afford to pump money more into your postcards. Postage is not cheap. But your intelligence is very valuable.
You take care of me, I'll supply you with the intelligence. That was our deal. That was our deal.
Very well.
You better come through, Gregor Hanserfreder.
Listen to me. We will hunt this man down.
I despise Godfrey. Eliminate him.
We must have him killed.
Very well.
And so it was decided, in the dark of night in the Nazi camp, that they would take care of Godfrey more permanently.
Introducing the new service by International Dateline. And that is International Dates. Are you want to get swept away in an international romance unparalleled to anything you've ever experienced before? International Dateline can help. Just call 1-800-963-8842. That's 1-800-963-8842. Now let's turn to some excellent testimonials from people who've had excellent experiences using the International Dateline.
The International Dateline. international dateline was so excellent for me. I met a lovely man from Japan who taught me how to say konnichiwa. It was so wonderful. And now we are going study on the internet 24/7. It's so excellent.
And that's the kind of service that the international dateline can provide. And now another testimonial.
So, I really didn't have much of a life, but I called the international dating service and date something service. I can't remember the name.
Dateline!
I called the international dateline service and they hooked me up with this really cool girl from Paris.
Thank you. And they lived happily ever after. And just give our service a call one more time and we have one last testimonial starting the services that we can provide.
I make a pizza in Italia. I make a pizza all day. It's hard to find an Italian girl who like a pizza maker. But in America, they love the pizza. I call the international dateline. I meet nice American girl. Thank you, international dateline. I give you a free pizza and a kiss on each cheek. Mwah! Mwah!
We now return to the fourth annual birthday broadcast. Par Avion.
Dearest Annie, I was in town today, here in port, and I got chased by these German soldiers. I don't know what's going on, but and I don't know why they're in this part of the world, but I'm very concerned that they might be searching for me. Hope all is well at home. Godfrey.
Godfrey all of a sudden began experiencing increasing German attention.
Dearest Annie, today I went to the market. The German soldiers came through. They were punching people and overturning carts left and right, smashing cantaloupes and guava fruit. I don't know what's going on, but I'm very sure they're coming for me. They seem to be following me somehow. Hope the county fares well. Godfrey.
He kept on the move, going from place to place, never failing to send a postcard back to the girl he loved.
Dearest Annie, I'm sorry I haven't gotten much time to write. The German attack is seemingly getting more intense. Hope all is well. Godfrey.
Meanwhile, back at home, Annie continued to receive postcards from Lawrence as well.
Dear Annie, I love the beach. It's full of sun and seagulls. I can't wait to hold you in my fingers again. Hugs and smooches, Lawrence.
But the postcards that came from Godfrey were more heartfelt, if written more hurriedly.
Dearest Annie, I love you dearly and think of you as I'm on the run. Sorry I haven't got more time to write. Godfrey.
And so, as the weeks and even the months passed, Godfrey's postcards kept coming. Frantic, sporadic, always hurried, and always with more and more mention of German danger.
Dearest Annie, saw the Germans today, hid under a trash can, escaped. Hope to hear from you soon. Godfrey. Dearest Annie, almost ran into the Germans again. Thankfully, we were able to steam away as they were only in a sail patrol boat. Hope to hear from you soon. Godfrey.
And so it went on and on. And as it went on, Godfrey began to wonder, why were they spending so much time chasing one lonely gunboat and its captain?
Dearest Annie, this is the first opportunity I've gotten to write you in weeks. The postcard is from the Dog's Palace. It's a local thing. But I'm starting to think that perhaps the Germans are targeting me specifically, perhaps because of my postcards. I'll have to look into this further, how they find out where I am and why they're targeting my dog gunboat. Hope to hear from you soon, Godfrey.
Godfrey Goodhart's ship, his small gunboat, pulled into the far distant port of Shanghai.
Listen, Eddie, I want you to find us a place to stay for tonight in Shanghai. With all the Germans around, it's too dangerous to stay on the boat.
Yes, sir. Got that covered.
Thanks, Ed. Watch out for the fog out there, too. It's getting thick.
Okay.
They walked through the streets of Shanghai, which seemed curiously empty, a fog swirling around them.
Doesn't seem like anyone's here.
Well, I think I see a light right over there. Let's try that in right there. What's that?
The dragon and slug?
That's weird.
Let's try it anyway. It's the only one that seems to be here.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll take it.
Hello, welcome to the Dragon's Log Inn. We pleasure to keep you what help you need. Can I help you?
I think Eddie and I would like a room for the night.
Janice, can you come help these men?
Coming!
Oh my god!
Wow, handsome! It's been so long since I've seen some nice American sailors coming into port.
Eddie, I think she's talking to you.
You're brawny! Woo!
Well, can you show us to our room?
Not you, the other guy!
No, sorry.
Do you have a girl back home?
Oh, yes I do, Annie.
Every guy I meet says that.
But Eddie's single, you know.
Eddie, wow. So you guys want a room?
Yes, please.
Okay, dokie. Let me see what I got here. Got a room. The Imperial Chinese Wall of Death Suite is open.
Is that the only room you've got available?
No, there's also the Humble Peasant's Lodge of Wisdom.
I think we'll take that.
Okay, come with me, please.
She led them down the corridor to a tiny little room with a thatched roof, which dripped water in one corner.
Here it is, Humble Peasant's Lodge of Wisdom. They say Confucius once stayed here. There's a haiku on the wall right over here. Want me to read it to you?
No, that's
all right. Ding-dong-dings, oh, ding-da-board, da-ding-dong-ding-ding-ding.
What does that mean?
Hang on, I got one more. Ding! It's very contemplative.
Oh, yeah, I can see that. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. If you need anything, don't hesitate to call. I just need your names for the guest book.
I'm Godfrey Goodheart.
I'm Eddie Buddy.
You're who?
Eddie Buddy.
Not you. What's your name again?
Godfrey Goodheart.
Goodheart is spelled,
is that spelled with two O's?
No, actually, it's spelled with two G's, Godfrey and Goodheart.
Oh, well, I got it. Well, that's wonderful. It's good to see both of you, and I hope you enjoy your stay for as long as it lasts and you're still alive before the Germans come and kill you.
What was that?
I said, many wisdoms take light, but the food of the immortals is the pleasantry of trees.
Oh, well, we'll have to book that one. Write that in the diary tonight.
Stay peace!
Yeah, stay peace to you. Ning Pao Shao. Oh. Well, nice place, except for the water.
Yeah, I think this will do for tonight. It's not that much worse than the ship.
No, that's true. All right, well, I guess it's time to bunk down for the night.
Little did they know as they started to drift off to sleep that Janice was up to no good.
Yes?
The cuckoo bird is in the nest, and the ham sandwich has been grilled.
I understand.
Hello.
Herr Commandant, I have news.
Excellent. What is it?
Godfrey Goodheart has been sighted in Shanghai.
Do you know this for sure?
Jawohl, Herr Gregor Hans of Frederick von Holstein. He is staying at the Dragon and Slug Inn on Good Luck Lane.
Excellent. Are there anybody with him?
And just one puny gunboat man. I can take care of him.
Fantastic. Go take him out.
Excellent.
Godfrey Goodheart lay in his bed with his pencil and a newly purchased postcard, trying to think what to write to Annie M. Appleby.
Dearest Annie, I don't know what to say. I'm in Shanghai now, and Eddie Buddy's with me.
What are you doing, Godfrey?
Oh, Eddie, I don't know what to write to Annie anymore. It's just such troubled times. I think about her so often, and this postcard's just not big enough. Who? What was that?
I'll go get it.
Room service!
Did you order something?
No, that didn't sound very much like Janice.
Room service! Hello, I have your Wiener Schnitzel and sauerkraut.
I didn't order any Wiener Schnitzel.
Eddie!
Ow.
Eddie!
And so the door burst open. And in burst the hugest German that Godfrey Goodhart had ever seen.
Oh my.
Godfrey Goodhart!
Yes.
I kill you now. And immediately he threw himself into a pitched battle with Godfrey Goodhart. Arms flailed, fists punched, feet kicked.
Rome salad! Help!
And soon he had the German guard had Godfrey Goodhart in a stranglehold.
And now, Godfrey Goodhart, no more postcards for you.
Mr. German, take that!
Eddie Buddy had struggled to his feet and hit the German with an immense cast iron pan over the head as the German toppled to the floor. Godfrey Goodhart sincerely thanked Eddie Buddy.
Oh, Eddie, I owe you my life, but we gotta get out of here.
Oh, go on without me, sir. I don't think I can last much longer.
But they decided that first they had to frisk the German to see if he might have any papers or documents on him.
Quick, let's check him for papers and documents. Hang on, Eddie. We're gonna get you back to the boat. Get you help.
They looked in the German's coat, and that's when Godfrey Goodhart pulled out the last thing he expected to see.
Hey, that looks kind of like one of your postcards.
It is a postcard, addressed to Annie Appleby.
Dear Annie, Shanghai is great. Much fortune, Cookie says, for my lucky number. Love, Lawrence.
Lawrence? I'm gonna kill him, quick! Get back to the boat, come on!
They decided to take the German guard with him. And as they got him onto the boat, he began to wake up, and they put him in the hold and began to question him.
What's the deal? Why do you have this postcard? And how do you know Annie?
I'll never talk.
Talk!
Okay, ow! Okay, so what happened is, your good friend Lawrence, he sold us military secrets he sold us military secrets.
Is that all you can say?
Military
secrets!
Can't tell
me anymore!
He wanted to marry the girl. We have been sending postcards to her the whole entire war. And soon, very soon, you will be killed. And Lawrence will marry her. And it won't matter because the Germans will rule the whole world!
Lawrence would do something like that, sniveling little... Oh.
Quick, we gotta go tell the general. It's an intelligence leak. Quick, get rid of the ship to sail. Eddie, you feeling all right?
I think so, sir.
But that's when Godfrey remembered. Lawrence was no mere minor officer now. In fact, he looked down at a stack of petty telegrams he had received in a sham of communication he had kept up with Lawrence, and noted how Lawrence recorded how he had risen through the ranks.
If he's in the position he claims to be in, then we can't send word via telegraph. We better keep radio silence, unless it's trivial and unimportant, like birthday wishes and things like that.
Sir, we could, I hear that Eisenhower is going to be touring Britain in 2 weeks.
2 weeks? We've got to get to Britain in 2 weeks from Shanghai. Get ready to the ship for sail. We got to get out of here.
Yes, sir.
Godfrey Goodhart had covered much ground in his time, but never, never had he had such a race as this.
Full steam ahead!
Yes, sir.
And so, the race began. The race, not just for Annie Appleby, but to save the entire free world.
Keep the ship on course, Eddie.
They steamed full ahead.
Burn everything you need to in the boilers. We can't afford to break down now.
I'm going as fast as I can, sir.
They sped across the waters, taking a direct line, dodging German patrol boats and hostile Japanese
forces. Keep a watch out there! Watch for airplanes and submarines!
Shh! That was close, sir.
If Lawrence was as high as he was in the intelligence force and was communicating to the Germans, there was no telling what military secrets he might have relayed.
It's gonna be tough, Eddie. There are ships everywhere. It's like they know where we're going.
You keep quiet, sir, so we can get through this really bad.
But just then, a German patrol boat careened around the coastline.
Walk over there, Eddie.
Bullets came spraying out at them.
I got it, sir.
They went as fast as they could and barely outran the German patrol boat.
Push in there, give us more power if you can, more power!
On and on like that it went, barely taking time to stop, to eat, to sleep. They just continued on, knowing that they had to get to Eisenhower in those 2 weeks.
I don't know if we can make it, Eddie. The coal's not looking good.
Oh, I think we can make it, sir. Just gotta keep pushing as hard as we can.
We're almost around Africa. We can get up a little more farther north. We might just be able to make it.
The consequences of not making it were dire.
The Allied cause will be lost if we don't. The intelligence lead at this level, it's the worst nightmare ever.
And so they continued down, around, through the Mediterranean, and finally, at long last, they were close, so close. They went to France, where they boarded an airplane to cross the channel.
All right, Eddie, you take care of the ship, get her refueled and cleaned up. I'm going to England to tell Eisenhower.
Yes, sir.
All right. Good luck, Eddie.
And so, the two men parted ways, closer than brothers. He got into his airplane cockpit, knowing that this was the last chance. As the airplane took off from the airstrip, he knew this was his last chance, and he could only hope that he might make it in time.
Oh, come on. Come on, Kraft. We gotta make it. Gotta just make it over in France and over the channel, and we're home free.
Ha ha! I have you in my sights now.
An unwelcome voice came over the radio.
Who is that? Over.
Who do you think it is? All right, you don't know me. My name is Gregor Hansa Friedrich von Holstein. I am a general in the German army and have been tracking you everywhere. Now, it is up to me to kill you.
How did you get this frequency?
That doesn't matter. All that matters now is that I'm going to kill you!
They dove through the air, weaving and ducking over the stormy channel. Godfrey picked up his radio.
Command control, command control, I'm under attack, under attack!
I have you now!
There was no reasoning with him. He was clearly insane and bent on taking Godfrey down. Godfrey did what he knew he had to do. As the planes dove towards the water, he kept his nose of his plane down, down, farther and farther, faster and faster towards the stormy ocean. And just as an incredible wave was about to hit, he pulled his plane out! The German's heavy plane couldn't stop. It plunged into the water and sunk beneath the tossing waves. Godfrey now knew that he was home free. He only had to get there, to the English camp, to talk to the general himself, Eisenhower. He knew that he had to tell him the truth, and so he navigated his plane down to the English airstrip.
This is Godfrey Goodhart with an urgent message for General Eisenhower. Over.
You are not clear to land on this airstrip. Please direct your course.
Where should I land? Over.
Anywhere, mate. Anywhere but this military base.
But this is a military craft. Over.
I'm sorry, you're not clear for this. I have to clear this frequency.
Wait, hold on.
So Godfrey Goodhart was forced to do the only thing he could. He's strapping himself into his parachute. He prepared to open the cockpit. He took one deep breath, looked at his picture of Annie M. Appleby he kept close to his heart. And then,
I love you, Annie. This is all for you.
He pushed the button. Down and down. His plane crashing into the English forest, he floated down closer and closer to the base where he knew that at last the truth would be revealed. Lawrence would be exposed and the whole Allied forces would be saved from devastation by the traitor. He landed within the confines of the base. Stripped off his parachute. In the distance, he could see the general reviewing the troops. He ran to go and to tell him the news.
Eisenhower! General Eisenhower!
But just then, a blow came from behind. He turned around, and there, standing over him, was the menacing figure of Lawrence.
Godfrey, what are you doing here?
Lawrence, what are you doing here?
I thought I got rid of you sooner.
Godfrey was exhausted. He had been traveling almost nonstop for 2 weeks. He had just had a battle over the English Channel. He just parachuted out of a plane. He didn't know if he had the strength to fight Lawrence now. As Godfrey lay defeated, Lawrence towered over him and smiled a grim smile.
Godfrey, I have to tell you something.
What?
I never loved that woman you love.
Annie.
I never loved Annie. Not as much as you did. I wanted her wealth. But now, seeing you defeated, I'll defeat you and the Allies and marry her and have all the money in the world. Goodbye, Godfrey.
And as he raised his hand to deliver the final blow.
Hello, gentlemen. What's going on here?
They turned.
General!
And there stood none other than Eisenhower himself.
What's the meaning of this?
This man...
Is
a spy.
Just a battle between friends, sir, that's all.
There are no battles between friends in my army. What do you mean he's a spy, Godfrey?
He lies!
This man is spying from his position in our intelligence services, sir.
He has no proof, sir.
He's been writing letters and telegrams all over the world, betraying our true positions.
You've always been jealous of me, Godfrey.
Lawrence, is this true?
I stand here to say, and say not. He's always been jealous of me.
MPs, arrest this man.
Never!
I was chased down by the Germans in Singapore and in Egypt, in Africa and in France. They knew where I was at every moment of every day. And that's only made possible by this man here.
Why would I do that, Godfrey? Why would I sell out my country?
Because
this country made me.
You love not humanity, but money. And you would betray our good cause for that, for a cheap coin.
Where are those MPs? MPs, arrest this man!
And I have these documents here that prove my point exactly.
Give them here. It is true.
Godfrey, this is not... This is forgery!
Arrest forgery!
Stop it!
And so the guards came up and arrested Lawrence.
Wait! You'll spend the rest of your days in jail for this.
Wait! You can take me, and I'm sure my name will be cleared, but let me tie my shoe.
He reached down to tie his shoe, and then he pulled out a sock pistol and aimed it at the general.
Oh my god!
Nobody move! Nobody move or I'll kill the general!
Stand down!
You stay there, Godfrey. I'm watching you. And you.
Godfrey knew.
And you in the corner.
He knew that he had to save everyone now. He knew that for his country, for the woman he loved, he had to defeat Lawrence one final time.
No one move!
And so, summoning his strength, he gathered himself and then leapt at Lawrence, tackling him in a huge jump and grabbing the gun out of his hands. He wrestled him on the ground, and then... A report rang out. Lawrence was dead.
Excellent job, Godfrey. MPs, take him to the morgue.
Thank you, sir.
ID him for sure. Find out how much damage this man has done to our campaign. You saved your country, young man. Excellent work.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And so Godfrey had. He had overcome the spy, Lawrence. And he had saved the Allied forces from the threat.
And as the plane flew back across the Atlantic, with Godfrey seated in first class, he could only think of one thing: the girl he loved, in the town he loved, in the home he loved, in the country he loved, but most of all, of the heart and the hand of Annie M. Appleby. The train pulled up to the station. And Godfrey stepped out onto his home soil of Waterford, Iowa, for the very first time. There had been parades in New York, afloat in Washington, D.C. Congress had shaken his hand, but none of those moments meant anything as much as breathing the cool, sweet air of his hometown again. Little had changed. Oh, the people there knew that he was a hero, and they were prepared to welcome him back, but he had come home a day earlier than anyone was expecting, because his heart would not be satisfied until he had seen and secured the hand of the woman he loved. He walked through the quiet streets, up to the old wooden schoolhouse with the red roof, and opened the door. There she stood, Annie M. Appleby. He had crossed continents for her, sailed across the world to the very farthest reaches of the globe, all for her hand. And now, at long last, he saw her. He walked down the long schoolhouse room. She looked up, the sunlight streaming in behind her, and saw him.
Godfrey!
Annie!
He ran to her and embraced her.
Oh, Annie! Annie!
Oh, you're home, you're safe.
You are too.
I'm so glad you made it back.
Me too. I missed you so much. Did you get my postcards? I wrote you every single one, every single day.
I know.
And now the time had come for him to ask the question that he had wanted to ask her for so long.
Annie M. Appleby, will you marry me?
I can't.
What? Why not?
Do you remember that promise I made to my mother about the postcards? Well, even though all of yours were real and heartfelt, well, Lawrence had one more. And I know that he's dead, but I have to keep my promise. So if I can't marry the most traveled man, I can't marry anyone.
Well, how many did he have? How short am I?
Well, he had 76, and you only have 75.
Oh, well, oh, gosh. Oh, I've got one in my pocket. Here, take that. That makes us even.
What? Well, that only makes you even. And that doesn't make one of you the winner. I don't know.
Miss Appleby?
Yes?
This just came in the mail for you.
What is it?
And there, in Annie M. Appleby's hand, was the very first postcard that Godfrey Goodhart had ever written.
Dearest Annie, it's been 3 days since I last saw you. I'm in training camp now here in Des Moines. Oh, I miss you dearly, and hope to hurry home to you soon, having seen more of the world than that dreadful person, Lawrence. Miss you dearly, Godfrey. Oh, it must have been misdirected. Look at all these postmarks and stamps and four mail forwarded signs. Par Avion.
Godfrey, it means you won. I can marry you.
Oh my gosh.
And so, the next month, they were married. Godfrey had traveled the world. He had overcome the evil Lawrence. But most important of all, he had won the heart of the girl he went around the world to marry.
This has been a Silverdome Radio Productions. Silverdome Radio is a division of Silverdome Productions, the fourth annual birthday broadcast. Par Avion. Today's cast included Alex Goodling.
Hello.
Anne Goodling.
Hey.
Sam Branshaw.
Howdy do.
Tage Danielson.
Hello.
Casey Somerville.
Hi.
David Somerville. Hi. And the benevolent, much loved, appreciated, applauded, celebrated, heroic, manly, courageous, terrific, amazing, wonderful, stupendous, superfluous, hyperbolic, Jason James Cunningham.
Who?
Thank you for joining us for this Silverdome Radio production.